And this is why the Aaronic order of priesthood came to an end in Eli's day. Because Eli had gotten old. He was 80-some years old, and he was a big, heavy man as well, and he could no longer control his sons. And those sons made themselves vile. Now, what did they do? They would lay carnally with the women of the congregation right in the very door of the church, the door of the temple, tabernacle. In this case, it was the temple, the very door of the temple. And he told them, you shouldn't be doing that, but they did it anyway. Now, they didn't offer the sacrifices anymore. They had servants that did the job for them. And so then a certain portion of that sacrifice was to be put in the seething pot. And the blood soaked out of it poured out onto the ground. And then that meat was to be put on the altar and burned. And when they would see the smoke ascending up from that altar, they could say, there go my sins, going on before into judgment. But these young men, under priests, they had servants. And they would take a flesh hook with three prongs, dig around down in the seething pot, and get the very best portions of meat out and give it to the priests. And if the man said, no, don't do that, that's supposed to be burned. And if it isn't burned, my sin won't be taken away. They said, you give it to us now or we'll take it by force, because our masters won't have raw or sodden flesh. There wasn't anything they could do about it. They couldn't move them only by death. Well, all three of them, Eli and his two sons, all died the same day. That was the end of the Aaronic order of priesthood. From that time on, they hired priests. But at any rate, in this day, you can be moved. You can be moved. If you're a deacon, the pastor can move you. If you're the pastor, God can move you. You remember we had that the very first night. So just don't think you can get away with anything today. So do it in the spirit of meekness, fearing lest yourselves also be tempted. Now come back to this. Restore such an one. Why do you have to restore them? Well, because you can't get a prayer through to God now. The Lord's hand is not shortened, cannot save. His ear is not heavy, cannot hear. But your sins and your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and he will not hear. So when you've gone into sin, you can't get a prayer through to God. Somebody's got to do it for you. All right? Let's go to 1 John, chapter 1. We'll get through here as quickly as we can. There's a little bit we need to do yet today. 1 John, chapter 1, verse 9. Ninth verse, let's read it. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, if you have not sinned, you have no need to confess your sin. But if you have sinned, you must confess your sin. And if you confess your sins, then God is faithful and just to forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. There is restoration for you. And it's a good thing. It's like this, the body of Christ. Well, let's take my natural body, since it's like the body. Supposing I break my arm, can it be healed? If there wasn't healing for that arm, I'd have a broken arm the rest of my life. But there's healing in my body. God in his body has provided healing for a broken arm or restoration for a backslidden saint. And if he hadn't done that, the first misstep you made would confine you to hell for the rest of eternity. And wouldn't any of us have been saved? Because every one of us have made mistakes. Every one of us have made mistakes. Peter made a mistake and Paul had to straighten him out. Paul made a mistake and Barnabas had to straighten him out. And if Peter and Paul could make mistakes and they were the greatest, I guess any of us could. All right? If we confess our sins. Now, who is John writing to? Writing to the church, not to the world. But the world, nominal preacher, will take this verse and preach it to the lost, So all you have to do is confess your sins. How do you confess your sins? Well, come on down the aisle, shake my hand. And the very fact of your coming is a confession. You're a sinner, that's all. You're saved now. So the evangelist then will get a great tent meeting, and he'll get 100 folks down there. All of them come down, and the very fact they've come down there, they confess their sins. Now you're saved now. Just go and join the church of your choice. Where'd you find anything like that in the Bible? This does not belong to the world. It belongs to us. So after you have been saved, if you commit sin, you are never going to be restored without a confession. Now, somebody said, oh, well, we'll just go in our closet and confess to God. How can you when he won't hear you? Let's go back for a minute and see. Remember now when Achan committed sin, and they went up to take Ai, and the battle went against them. They didn't need to take very many because it was only a few, but the battle went against them, and 36 men lost their lives. And Joshua fell down on his face before God. Lord, what's going on here? You didn't fight for us today. We lost 36 men. And God said to Joshua, get up, Joshua. This isn't praying time. Oh, I thought you told me prayer is the answer to all things. No, it isn't. Sometimes it's something to do. Get up from here, Joshua. There's sin in the camp. Find out where the sin is and deal with that case. And then I can fight your battles again. And he told him how to do it. He caused the tribes to pass before him. One tribe was taken, caused the families to pass before him. Then one family was taken, then he caused the individuals, and Achan was taken. And Achan, Joshua said to Achan, says, Achan, what have you done? Committed sin here and caused 36 men to lose their lives. Now, confess to God. Tell me now what you've done. And Achan said, thus and thus have I done. Somebody said, oh, you don't have to tell the details. Just say you've sinned. That doesn't mean a thing. In the 5th chapter of Leviticus, he said, if you have sinned in any of these things, you have to confess that you have sinned in that thing. Had an elderly woman one time come to me, to my board, to make a confession. She says, I don't know how to say it. It's too bad to talk about. I said, sister, if it wasn't too bad to do, it's not too bad to talk about. Mm-hmm. Confess what you've done. He said, thus and thus have I done. Now, you know, the Lord had said that they should not take anything, not touch anything, because it was all accursed. And this is when they had gone to Jericho. They weren't to take anything. It was all accursed. But he said, I saw a goodly Babylonian garment, and I saw a wedge of gold, and I saw some shekels of silver, and I looked at them. That's the first sin. Should have turned away. I looked, lust built up in my heart. I coveted. Then I took it. Then I hid it under the floor of my tent. So nobody'd know what I've done. I did all these things step by step. This is what I did. That's how you make a confession. And you make it to those that are spiritual, that have the right to receive that confession, to restore you. Don't think you're going to get by just saying, Brother Pastor, I've sinned. Pray for me. Now, there's something more than that. You confess that you have sinned in that thing. Thus and thus have I done. All right. Now, some of our brethren have said that this first chapter is a license to sin. Because you can do anything you want to do, and they'll just come and confess, and we'll pray for you, and that's the end of it, and just do anything you want to do. But that's not a license to sin. Second chapter, first verse. My little children, these things write I unto you. What things? The things in the first chapter. These things write I unto you, that you sin not. I wrote them so you wouldn't sin. I didn't write them to give you a license to sin. I wrote them so you wouldn't sin. But I know human nature, so we're not going to stop here. Read on. He didn't stop to catch his breath. And if any man sin, now who can sin? Any man, any man, any man. If any man sin, he has an advocate. No, he doesn't. No, we. We who? We that are spiritual. We that have not sinned. We have an advocate with the Father. All right, read. Who's the Father? Jesus Christ the righteous. That's the scripture that opened my eyes to the Godhead 57 years ago. Jesus Christ the righteous is the Father. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. So, if he has sinned, he can't get to God for himself. So he's got to come to us, make his confession to us, and we'll get to God for him. We will restore him. We will restore him. Now, I had an evangelist one time in Kalamazoo, and I noticed a backslider sitting in the congregation. Hadn't seen him for some time. When I got up to make the altar call, backslider got up and came on down to the altar. Bowed down, began to pray. Well, I just kneeled down beside him, tried to talk to him, tell him that we'd meet him after the service was closed, deal with his case. He paid no attention to me whatsoever. Absolutely ignored me. So nothing I could do. I just got up and went on with the altar call. When the service was over, he got up and went back to his seat. Well, after he was satisfied, got up and went back to his seat. So after the service was over, I said to the evangelist, well, you've seen a new thing tonight. The Bible says nothing new under the sun, but you saw something new tonight. You saw a backslider restore himself. Of course, he wasn't restored. He never did come back anymore. If he'd have had repentance, we could have restored him. But he couldn't restore himself. If he was willing to make a confession, we could have restored him. But he couldn't restore himself. All right? Oh, let's see now. We have an advocate. He doesn't have it. We've got it. Doesn't the Bible say, confess your faults one to another? Well, then, I don't have to go to the pastor. I can just go to just anybody. Because I don't want the pastor to know, because he lose confidence in me. See, I don't have that authority. You go to your pastor. He has that authority and the responsibility. All right? But didn't it say, confess your faults one to another? All right, we'll read it, and this will be the end for today. Turn to the book of James. James chapter 5. What do you do if you're sick? What are you supposed to do? Call for the elders of the church? Now, wait a minute. You see, this is only because you don't know the Bible like you ought to know. I don't say this to embarrass anybody, but I'm making a point now. You've got to remember this now. Mm-hmm. You see, you don't start with the 14th verse. You start with the 13th verse. 13th verse. All right, let's read the 13th verse. Any among you afflicted, let him call for the elders of the church. Oh, what? Let him pray. You ought to be able to pray for yourself, hadn't you? Brother, you ought to be able to pray for your wife, hadn't you? You ought to be able to pray for your children, hadn't you? Didn't the scripture say, these signs shall follow them that believe, they shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover? He didn't say just the ministers. He said, them that believe. You see, the problem is, we get to the place where we don't want to do anything for ourselves. Put everything on the pastor. Let the pastor do everything. I'll tell you what. No use you trying to bring people in. Let the pastor go out and bring them in. Of course, you don't have to preach to them because you're not a preacher. Then let him preach to them. Well, then they've got to be, they're ready to be baptized. Well, let him baptize them. Now they need to tarry. Well, let the pastor tarry. Uh-oh. I guess you get the point. God expecting every one of us to be laborers, servants in the church. Every one of us. All right? So now, is any afflicted? Any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Well, I'm going to give you an illustration again. We had a family of saints. A number of children. They lived 9 miles out in the country. And this was back in Depression days. And three times in 1 week, they called me to come out and pray for a sick child. Three different children in 1 week. And things were so tight back there, I didn't have gasoline enough to drive 18 miles. Nine out and nine back. I didn't have any money to buy the gas. I had to borrow money to buy enough gas to get out there and pray for their children. Wintertime, when I got there, went to the house and asked, well, where's the sick child? Out in the yard playing. I had to go out and run him down to pray for him. Now, couldn't that father have done a little praying himself? Couldn't the mother have done a little praying? But instead of that, knowing the situation, and I had to borrow money three times that week and go out there and run down a sick child playing out in the yard. Is any sick among you, any afflicted among you? What? Pray. You better be able to do some praying for yourself. All right, now let's look at the other side of the picture. Is any merry? I'm glad he didn't say gay, because we'd have a time with that word now, wouldn't we? Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. All right, now, read. Is any sick among you? Well, haven't you already prayed? You've already prayed, but your prayer didn't get through. Something stopped your prayer from getting through. So now what do you do? Let him call for the elder. Elders. Elders of the church. All right. Now, wait a minute. Where is this man? Oh, he come to church and he got in the prayer line? Well, if he did, he didn't have to call for the elders to come to him. No, this man is sick in bed. He can't get up. He can't get to church. All right, keep that in your mind. Let him call for the elders of the church. All right, read. And let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And incidentally, this is the only scripture in the Bible that authorizes you to anoint with oil. Now, there's anything wrong in you doing it, because it's a type of the baptism or a type of the Holy Ghost. But now, you have an oil bottle, I'm sure there's be an oil bottle in this pulpit. Somebody comes up here for prayer, you'll get out the bottle and anoint them. You didn't have any scripture to do that. This is one, and this is not at the church, this is in the sick man's room. Now, once again, nothing wrong in it, I do it myself, because it symbolizes. But there isn't anything in that oil that's going to do any healing. There isn't anything in these hands that's going to do any healing. And I can tell you, numbers of people have been healed under these hands. On one occasion, a dead person was raised under these hands. I know what God can do. There isn't anything in these hands. It's God. God that does it. And if he wants to do it, he can do it. If he doesn't want to do it, no use you stomping your feet and crying and hollering. It isn't going to be done. All right? Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall heal the sick. Oh, not heal it? Save the sick. Oh, why does he need to be saved? He's one of the saints. Well, he's got into something, and that's why his prayer didn't get through to God for himself. That's why he had to call the elders. The prayer of faith shall save the sick. Now the block that prevented his prayer getting through is gone. Now we can get a prayer through for healing. And then what will happen? And the Lord will raise him up. But he's got to be saved first, restored first, before he can be raised up. All right? Read. And if he has committed sin, it shall be forgiven him. Why? Because he has got the elders there to pray for him. And it's through their prayer. But there's something had to be done for that prayer to be effective. Read on now. Confess your faults one to another. Pray one for another. Wait a minute. Where are we now? In the sick room. Who's in the sick room? The sick man and the elders. So now there's a confession taking place. So the elders are confessing to the sick man? The sick man's confessing to the elders. So then when you're confessing one to another, who are you going to confess to? The elders. You confess to the elders. You don't just get your friend and or wife confess to husband, or husband confess to wife. You confess to the elders. That's confessing one to another. All right? Confess your faults one to another. Pray one for another that you may be healed. Read. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. All right? Now, no matter how fervently he prays, if his prayer isn't effectual, it isn't going to do anything, is it? What's going to make it effectual? The honest confession of the sick man makes his prayer effectual. So then his prayer can get through to God, and the man can not only have his sin taken care of, but also be healed. So don't get the idea now you can just confess to anybody. You only confess to those that have the authority to take your confession. And that is the pastor with his deacon board. Now, I hope I haven't been too hard on you. But if you think I have, just remember, I didn't write the book. I just told you what was in it. Now, just before I close, is there any question that any of you'd like to ask? Something I've said that you just didn't get quite clear? You'd like to get a little clarification? Or maybe just some other question, something that's troubling you right now? Any question? If there's no questions, I'll give you back in the hands of your pastor at this time.